TheYeshiva.net.
Eis tzara hili Yaakov umimena yivashaya. This is a distressful time for the Jewish people and for all peoples, for the entire planet, for the world. It's not a time for panic, fear, and hysteria, but it is a time for deep conscientiousness, caring, awareness, inner unity, and responsibility. I am deeply perturbed, and frankly, it's shocking that many people in our communities are completely unaware, perhaps with good intentions, but unaware of the seriousness of the situation. They almost mock at the word quarantine as though it was an invention of some health official who decided it's a good thing and he must not oblige by it. But my dearest friends, you know who invented the idea of quarantine? You know who invented the halacha of quarantine? You know who invented the obligation to go into quarantine? You know who? The Jewish people. Almost 2,000 years ago in the Gemara and Masechta Baba Kama, and then recorded in the halachic authorities in Shulchan Aruch, Yoyre Deya, Simen Kuf Te Zayin. This is a Jewish invention that the Gentiles took from the Jewish people. Hundreds and hundreds of years ago, thousands of years ago, before we knew about microbes and microorganisms and viruses and DNA and RNA and host cells. Our sages, living hundreds and hundreds of years ago, instructed the Jewish people to quarantine in a time of a pandemic, in a time of an infectious disease that is traveling from person to person. To quote one of the greatest halachic authorities in history, the Ramah, Rabbeinu Moshe Isserlich, the rabbi of Krakow in Poland, 16th century, Yoyre Deya Simen Kuf Te Zayin, when there's a pandemic in the city, one is obligated to flee, to go away from the people living there. He or she must leave the city in the beginning, not wait till the end, in the beginning. Quoting the greatest of Ashkenazic halachic authorities, Tshuvas Ma'aril 35. And the Marmos says, V'cholelu advarim hei mishum sakona. This is all because of endangering lives. V'shoymer nafsha yirchak mayhem. Anyone who cares for life must be very conscientious to stay distant from such an epidemic. V'asur lismoich anes. And you're not allowed to rely on a miracle. Oy lesake nafsha b'chol kayotze b'za. Or endanger your life through doing anything. This is hundreds of years ago. And you could look in all of the commentators there in the Shulchan Aruch and in Rebecca Vegan and many other commentators. You think these people did not know about the power of unity and the power of prayer and the power of learning? Of course they knew. These are the greatest spiritual and halachic authorities of the Jewish people. But they also knew that the same God who told us to go to shul and the same God who told us to go to weddings and to go to the mikveh and to mingle together and to fabring together and to dance together told us that saving one life is saving the world, and God forbid causing the death of one life is like causing the destruction of the entire world. Saving a life overrides the entire Torah. The Ramah says, don't rely on miracles. He knew about faith. He knew about the power of prayer. He says, don't rely on miracles. And I want to just clarify this for some people who may not understand what's going on. Just these viruses travel very, very fast. They're extremely contagious. If somebody has the coronavirus, mingles with people, even if he or she infects only one more person, that's one more person or two people. It's usually more, but let's say two people. And every day, that doubles. So day one, only one person has the virus. Day two, two people have the virus. Day three, four people have the virus. That's not a big deal, right? The next day, eight people have the virus. Do you know? You could take a calculator, do the math. By the time you reach day 27, day 28, you have reached the entire United States of America. 350 million people. By the time you hit day 30, you reached 1 billion people. You don't have to feel sick to pass on the virus to somebody. You don't have to have symptoms to pass on the virus. I can have the coronavirus inside. It's not endangering my life. My immune system may be perfect and healthy. And yet, I walk into my mother's home. I touch the doorknob. And a senior citizen, somebody who's over 60, especially over 70, especially over 80, I may be endangering their life. So what happens if in 30 days more than 1 billion people have it? What happens if 5 or 10% of a population, as it is with senior citizens, their life becomes endangered? So you have in one moment, within a few weeks, millions of people whose lives are at risk. There's no enough beds in the hospital, not enough ventilators, not enough respirators, not enough doctors, not enough hospitals. What happened in Italy? They didn't take it seriously. There are days now that there are more than 300, 400 deaths in a day in one region. They're not allowed to even bury the corpses. They pile them up in churches and other places. They're not allowed to bury the corpses. I was reading two or three days ago an article in one place, 300 dead. You say, I'm feeling good. I know I'm feeling good. Baruch Hashem, everybody should feel good. But you can catch it from somebody and give it to somebody. You can have it and give it to somebody. In 1918, there was an influenza, a Spanish flu. It killed between 30, 50 million people, some say 100 million people. A tale of two cities. In Philadelphia, they didn't take the warning seriously. They knew about the flu, but they had a parade of 200,000 people. Within 3 days, every bed in every hospital was filled, and within 2 weeks, close to 5,000 people were dead. In St. Louis, they took it very seriously. They closed down every place where people gathered, churches and schools, everything. And what happened? The amounts of victims was completely paled in comparison to what happened in St. Louis. Literally a tale of two cities in 1918. Italy warns. They didn't take it seriously. My dearest friends, what's the solution for this? Pray to God, but quarantine. What happens if I lock myself up in my home with my immediate family? First of all, if I don't have it, I'm not catching it from outside. If I do have it, I'm not passing it on to anybody else. But I go outside, I go to the store, I go to the street, I meet somebody, I sneeze, I go into a store, I touch a doorknob. Either I gave it to somebody else or I got it from somebody else. And if somebody over 60, over 70, over 80 gets it, their lives, God forbid, can be in danger. And people don't realize within a few weeks, you reach a critical mass of hundreds of thousands of millions of people. If we quarantine, the virus travels, but much slower. So people are recovering. While more people are getting ill, it doesn't happen within a concentrated space. It happens, it's more stretched out. They call it flattening the curve. When people are quarantined, it doesn't spread so fast. One day, 2 days, 3 days, doubling, tripling, quadrupling, and by the time you come to day 20, you're dealing with the millions. It slows down. So when somebody, God forbid, gets very sick and they need emergency help, there's help available for them. There's help available for these people. If not, God forbid, you can have questions of life and death. An 80-year-old comes to a hospital. A 50-year-old comes to a hospital. Who do we treat? We only have one bed in the ICU. We only have one doctor. We only have one ventilator. Who do we treat? We have one respirator. Who do we treat? Heaven forbid we should have to come to those questions. If you slow it down, according to nature, this dever is curtailed, it's curbed, it's controlled, until Be'ezer Hashem, the virus dies out and our planet comes back to healing. May it be swift. May everybody stay healthy. May all of you be healthy. All of your loved ones be healthy. All of the Jewish people be healthy. And all of the world to be healthy. May this usher in a new era of unity and oneness and clarity and conscientiousness and the deep sense of camaraderie that we're feeling. The whole world is one. The whole world is one. And we're God caught everybody off guard. Hashem caught everybody off guard. And I turn to all of you, friends and students and constituents and brothers and sisters the world over. This is a very, very serious time. Rise up to the occasion and be responsible fathers, responsible mothers, responsible rabbis, teachers, clergy, mentors. It's time for responsibility. It's not a time to mock and to be cynical and to dismiss such a serious issue that our sages understood thousands of years ago. Reb Mendel Levitepsker has a letter, 1786. He was quarantined from Purim till after Shavuos in Tiberias in Tveria. One of the greatest Hasidic masters, Reb Mendel LeHaradoka, the pre-Aretz, quarantined. He has a letter, quarantined with a few people. Rabbi Akiva Eiger, one of the greatest halachic authorities, has a letter in the 1830s. There was a cholera that swept through Eastern Europe, killed hundreds of thousands of people. He does not allow more than a few people. He says more than they should have police by every shul, not allowing more than a few people to come together, more than 50 people to come together. Give me. Finally, at last, before I begin the actual class, we are all quarantined. I'm also quarantined. I stopped giving I gave every day for many years, more than one class every single morning in shul with a lot of people attending. It's sad for me, it's heartbreaking for me. I'm home and I'm continuing the classes, but it's quarantined here with my dear wife and my immediate family. My other family, siblings, and are all in their own homes, in their own places. It's a difficult time for all of us. It's a very difficult time. But let's remember, we don't call the shots. We are in the hands of God, and we are His servants. And right now, this is our mission. Let's embrace it with clarity, with pride, with dignity, with celebration, with humility, with love, and with an inner sense of conviction and purpose. And I'm going to share with you an insight by the previous Lubavitcher Rebbe that has always touched me very deeply, but now can truly resonate with all of us. He escaped Nazi-occupied Warsaw, and he arrived to New York in March 1940, the second ninth day of Adar 2, 1940, he arrived in New York. This is the sixth Lubavitcher Rebbe, Rabbi Yosef Yitzchak Schneerson. He passed away in 1950 in New York. For Pesach, he was in Lakewood, New Jersey. And at one of the meals of Pesach, I heard this from a Jew, Reb Herschel Fogelman, from Worcester, Massachusetts, of blessed memory. The Rebbe said these words. We say in the Hallel, Ono Hashem ki ani avdecho. King David says, please God, help me. I am your servant. But the sentence seems flawed. Please God what? It doesn't say please God help me. It just says please God because I'm your servant. Ono Hashem ishiyana, please God help me. Hatzlichana, give me success. Here the sentence is missing something. And the Rebbe said, it doesn't mean please, because it's not spelled Aleph Nun Aleph. If it would have spelled Aleph Nun Aleph, Aleph Nun Aleph is please. Ona Hashem Hashiyana is spelled Aleph Nun Aleph. That means please. This Ona is spelled Aleph Nun Hey. Doesn't mean please, it means we're. Ona Selech, we're. What King David is saying, David HaMelech is saying, Ona Hashem Ke'ani Avdecha. We're Hashem, because I'm your servant. Tell me where you want me to be, because I am your servant. We don't control a lot of the circumstances of our life. We don't control where we are. we are now quarantined. At such a moment, we look up and we say, Ana Hashem, wherever you want me to be, ki ani avdecha, I'm your servant. This is a unique moment now. There's a unique mission now. We can't wrap our brain around it, but we have to be open, full of faith, confidence, trust, an inner sense of conviction, an inner sense of joy. No panic and fear, but conscientiousness, responsibility, leadership, caring, and empathy. And people have to stand up for the truth and not allow mockers and cynics or people who really don't understand what they're doing to call the shots. Because this is antithetical to everything Judaism stands for in a time when there's a health crisis, literally of life and death. At such a moment, I turn to God, we turn to God, and you say, Ana Hashem, wherever you want me to be, I'm going to embrace it with dignity, ki ani avdecha. Use this opportunity. It's a time for introspection. It's a time for prayer. It's a time for tshuva. It's a time for a lot of extra learning of Torah. Especially it's a time for bonding with your intimate family, with your immediate family. Working out issues, getting rid of the toxicity. Opening up our hearts, cleaning up our homes, not only physically, but spiritually, emotionally. Bonding with your spouse, with your children in ways that maybe you couldn't do for years because all of us were running all over the place. Yesterday I sat down with my family for a lunch at 1 o'clock in the afternoon and I turned to my wife and I said, I don't remember the last time I did this in America, in New York, to sit down with your family for lunch. It almost felt like I was in Mexico City or in South America where the world stops for lunch. This is New York. This is New York. It's the microwave generation. We like it hot and we like it fast. Somebody in Manhattan once got a ticket because he was driving 50 miles per hour and the ticket said double parking. They say the serenity prayer in New York is, God, give me patience and give it to me now. It's a unique opportunity, my friends. Embrace it. Open yourself up to it. Pray for the world. Pray for yourself. Pray for your family. Have trust and faith. Open your hearts, be responsible. Use these moments for transformation, for renewal, for rebirth. God has his plans. Wash your hands constantly, but remember in whose hands we are in. Take a deep breath and surrender to the new reality of our world. Together, with the power of our unity, with the power of our conviction, with the power of our prayers, and with our absolute commitment to life and to health and to saving lives. May Hashem cleanse the world from this frightening coronavirus and bring in a new era of healing and ultimately an era of redemption, cosmic healing, cosmic oneness speedily in our days.
This class is brought to you by the yeshiva.net. Please help us continue the classes. Make even a small contribution at www.theyeshiva.net/donate.